Good evening. Welcome to Chartwell Booksellers. This is a very nice crowd to see in this store. You here in the store, welcome, and welcome to all of you out there, wherever you may be, watching live our first simulcast from Chartwell Booksellers on our website and on YouTube. It's incredible. The first event that we ever held in Chartwell in 1983, just after opening, was a reading, and we read from right here on this spot. Mark Halperin read from his then new book, A Winter's Tale. 31 years later, we are here on this very spot once again, but simulcasting to the world. Thomas Maier and his new book, When Lions Roar, The Churchills and The Kennedies. We're delighted to have Mr. Maier here with us. Thank you to Crown Publishers for getting him here. Thomas Maier is the renowned author of four previous books, including The Kennedys, America's Emerald Kings. He remains a very active reporter for Newsday. He is no doubt best known at this moment as the man who wrote Masters of Sex, the life and times of William Masters and Virginia Johnson, the couple who taught America how to love. That is the full official title. This book, of course, gave birth to the current hit Showtime series that everybody is watching. It's difficult at this late date to write from a new angle about Winston Churchill. Take it from me. So much has been written. We're surrounded by it. So much has been said. How do you cite this man anew? The same is true of Joseph Kennedy to a certain extent, though Kennedy in his lifetime tried to obscure his own movements considerably more than Winston Churchill did. Thomas Maier has found a way to cast new light on these two epic figures by literally refracting each of them through the other man's life. The result is a panoramic chronicle of the many ways that Winston Churchill and Joseph P. Kennedy and their progeny crossed paths and swords over the course of the 20th century. When Lions Roar is an extraordinary achievement. Ladies and gentlemen, Thomas Maier.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. And Barry, thank you so much for being such a gracious host. It means a lot, those words, because I know you are familiar, as perhaps none other, with the canon of Churchill books. So I really greatly appreciate that. And just to take care of some business here, I wanted to thank Vanessa Mobley, my editor, our crackerjack team at Crown, including Diana Messina. I'd like to thank my agent, John Wright, who is here, my longtime teacher, Father Ray Schroth, in the back, and my three sons, Drew, Taylor, oh, Drew's over here, Taylor and Reed, and my lovely wife, Joyce, last but not least, we celebrated our 30th wedding anniversary last night. So, see, Joyce, I said that would get a clap there when I said that. Once again, thank you so much for joining me. You know, ironically, one of the many different ironies when you do a book, sometimes you'll see something on television and it somehow will coincide with what you're doing. And I don't know if anybody here has followed Boardwalk Empire, which is the TV show that just finished up. But this last final season, they had a fictional Joe Kennedy in their a number of episodes. And in that this past season on Boardwalk Empire, Joe, the fictional Joe Kennedy, tries to get into a liquor deal with Nucky Thompson, who is the star of that show for those who follow it. And it turns out they don't do business. And I had a laugh when I was watching it because in many ways, When Lions Roar, my book, I think casts a lot of new light on exactly what was going on with Joe Kennedy's British liquor deal. And in fact, as we reported last week in Time magazine, the real-life liquor deal in 1933 involved Winston Churchill, and FDR's son, Jimmy Roosevelt. This was a story that was hiding in plain sight involving two presidential families and a future prime minister. And yet nobody seemed to understand or really know about this story to any great extent. Why is that? Why was things not known about them? And why 50 years, almost to the date that Winston passed away, have we never read, has there not been a book about the Churchills and the Kennedys? And that's what this book attempts to do. It tries to look at a story that has been hiding in plain sight for many, many years. And one of the reasons why it lingered there unknown is because I think a number of the parties, frankly, didn't want it all that well known. Much of the histories about both the Kennedys and Churchill himself were written after World War II. There's that old maxim that the victors will write the history, and Winston certainly was well aware of that. He took all of his papers and wrote a history of World War II. So when people would say after World War II that, oh, Joe Kennedy and Winston Churchill, they hated one another. The Kennedys and the Churchills hated one another, and because of their differences over World War II, to some extent that's true. But like most things in life, it's a lot more complicated than that. And in fact, their stories were not really running parallel, but they were two dynastic families with a number of different interconnections. The cast of characters in this story is a big part of the story itself. Not only just the two families, but all of the various different characters who intersect with both families, who are friends with both families. And so in a sense, I would like to suggest that this book fundamentally rewrites history and what is known about the history between these two iconic families. It's never been said before. And the arc overall of my book is one of two sets of families who were friendly acquaintances, some business acquaintances, social acquaintances, to some degree political acquaintances. And then tragically, they are at loggerheads over World War II. Joe Kennedy perceives it, like many other Americans who were isolationist at that time, as something that would mean death and destruction, that he believed, like most isolationists, in the words of the warning of our first president, George Washington, who warned about foreign entanglements. They had lived through World War I, and knowing Joe, he probably didn't see anything good for the Irish out of this thing. Winston, of course, saw that it was nothing less than the survival of England, his beloved British Empire. And not only that, but that Hitler posed a fundamental threat to human freedom, dignity, nothing less than Western civilization itself. And of course, he was very accurate and very true about that. So we had friends, then tragic antagonists during World War II. And then another surprise to me in the overall arc is that these two families that had been at loggerheads bitterly had seen the death and destruction in their lives. And yet they, by the late 50s, early 60s, particularly, the second generation of these two families become friendly again in very surprising, at least to these eyes, ways. Randolph Churchill became very friendly with JFK, Robert Kennedy, and Jackie Kennedy, among others. So in many ways, this book is about, when we talk about themes and we were to write a book report on this, heaven forbid you get that assignment, that this is a book where it's about legacy. It's about greatness. It's about fathers and sons and the alchemy and the expectations and all the different things that are part of that relationship. In many ways, it is the stuff that Shakespeare himself wrote about. And I think both those families were very keenly aware of their Shakespeare as it applied to life and their lives in general. The two big pillars in my book, the two tent poles, if you will, are Winston and JFK. And they're the constant touchstones in this book, but there's a lot that they had in common. So if I may, let me just start that way. They were both underestimated youths. People who are familiar with Winston's story knows that he had an awful relationship with his father, Lord Randolph, who had more than his fair share of problems, who died at a relatively young age after a mercurial rise to power. He became the Chancellor of the Exchequer. But he was always a very distant parent for Winston. And his father made it very clear that he was nothing less than a disappointment. His mother was also distant and had a very active social life, as they say, and had a number of different lovers and friends and really was concerned about a lot of things except Winston. And there are very poignant things that Winston says about his church, about his early life. JFK, when we meet JFK early on in this book, he is a very sickly young boy. He's living not only in the shadow of his father, a great man, a multi-million, you know, a captain of industry, a multi-millionaire during at a time in which most people could barely afford meals or a home. This is, you know, in the early 30s. And we meet Jack Kennedy, who is not only sickly, but he lives in the shadow of his father, but also his older brother, Joe Jr., who everybody expects will someday become president, or certainly his father expects that he'll become president of the United States. So they're both underestimated youths, if you will. As adults, though, they grow and they become warriors, young warriors, and they have a taste, they have a familiarity with war, and are able to write about it and to express about what they observed about war. It becomes part of their experience as adults. They are also historians and literary figures. I mean, just imagine how lucky I am as an author when I have Winston, who has won the Nobel Prize in Literature, and then you have Jack Kennedy, who is a Pulitzer Prize winner for Profiles in Courage. He wins for biography. So these were men of words who translated their words into action as statesmen. And a lot of this was, you can see throughout their lives, how their sense of history, their sense of words about literature itself informed so much of who and what they were. Another thing that, though, that was perhaps most delightful for me is that they both shared a sense of wit, a sense of humor. And it's one of those things that I always delighted in, doing this book, because there was always some phrase that Winston had or JFK had. I was thinking, for instance, of Winston's experiences in war, and there's so many different wars that he actually observed as a reporter, as a journalist. He's making his living as a writer. Poor devil. And he's at the Boer War. He's watching that. He's watching the whirling dervishes in the last cavalry charge in the Sudan. And he says at one point after their an experience in which he is just almost crazy, frankly, where there's a scene during the Boer War in which he's captured, and there's a price put on his head. But he talks about war, and he says, "There's nothing in life so exhilarating as to be shot at without result." When he talked about the switching parties from conservative, then over to the Liberal Party when things were going that way, and then he went back to the Conservative Party. And he said, "Well, anyone can rat," he explained, "but it takes a certain amount of ingenuity to re-rat." In World War II, right after waiting 2 years for America to enter the war, he rushes off I believe with Lord Beaverbrook is with him, but it's at the beginning of the war, and he comes to the White House and spends Christmas at the White House for a couple of weeks. He's there, and they're planning essentially how they're going to combat Hitler, how they're going to win the war, their plans for it. And Winston is taking a bath, and apparently FDR had a sudden thought that he just had to tell Churchill. So he was taken in his wheelchair, and he was wheeled right into Winston's room, and there's Winston, naked as a jaybird, coming out of the bath, and needless to say, FDR is all flustered by this, and Winston says, "Pray enter. The Prime Minister of Great Britain has nothing to hide from the President of the United States." In a similar sense, JFK kind of had that same sense of humor, a very subtle, keen wit when he talked about PT 109, which, depending upon your point of view, is both heroic and catastrophic on Jack Kennedy's watch. But his father, Joe Kennedy, took it as an opportunity to publicize his son. And so there were all these wonderful, heroic stories about Jack Kennedy that appeared in The New Yorker, was later excerpted in Reader's Digest, it was in The New York Times. But when Jack himself, years later, was asked, how did he become a war hero? He said, "It was involuntary. They sank my boat." You know, he was also one who was aware of the tensions culturally between Irish Catholics and the British. And that's a big part of the cultural background that informs my story, both with Churchill and particularly with the Kennedys. In 1956, Jack is running for Congress, and he sees in the local press all these references to Lady Astor being friends with his mother Rose, his sister Kit being referred to as Lady Harrington. So Jack urgently sent a note out to his family. He said, "Let's not forget that I'm running for Congress, not Parliament." So that, and one last thing, if I can throw one in 1960, there was all the talk about Joe Kennedy being the hidden hand behind Jack's campaign. And indeed, as readers of When Lions Roar, we'll hopefully find out. Joe Kennedy not only financed his son's campaign, but he was the major fundraiser for FDR in 1932. But in 1960, there was talk about this, and Jack Kennedy, with that same sense of humor, he got up before a group of folks, including the press, and he said, "I have here a telegram from my father." He says, the telegram reads as follows: "Dear Jack, don't buy a single vote more than is necessary. I'll be damned if I'm going to pay for a landslide." I have to say, one of the many different interconnections of the Kennedys and the Churchills is the actor Richard Burton, who there's somebody I know who's the star of a well-known TV program, Michael Sheen, who sees Richard Burton as a big hero of his. But Burton obviously was on stage as Camelot, which kind of became the motif for the Kennedy years. But he was also somebody who played Winston. And if I may, and I'm not a big fan of this, but I just like to, for a moment, just read an excerpt from my book. And this is something that always I enjoyed. And I know Michael Sheen himself has actually said this story as well. So if I may, here we go. At London's Old Vic Theatre in 1953, moments before his performance in Shakespeare's Hamlet would begin, actor Richard Burton received unsettling news. Winston Churchill was in the audience. "Do be good tonight, my dear boy," the theatre director admonished, "because the old man is in front." Suddenly in terror, the young Welsh actor looked through a spy hole and spotted the Prime Minister. After 6 years as the opposition leader in Parliament, Churchill had finally returned to 10 Downing Street. He had also just won the Nobel Prize in Literature for his lifetime devotion to memorable writing and rhetoric. For those like Burton, who came of age during the war, Churchill was a paterfamilias and an embodiment of the British Empire. A bit buzzed from drink, Burton quickly doused his head in cold water, a necessary tonic, quote, to bring myself to my senses. Every bristle of his hair seemed to stand up on its own until he flattened it with grease, and then he stepped out onto the stage to recite the bard's words, keenly aware of his childhood hero in the front row. As the play progressed, Burton could hear a murmuring in the darkness, a voice from the audience reciting every line of Hamlet, just as he was saying it, word for word. Quote, it was Churchill speaking the lines with me, Burton recalled, and I could not shake him off. Burton sped up, slowed down, to no avail. When he tried cuts in the bard's play to get Churchill to stop, he could hear a growl at the diversion. He knew the play intimately, recalled Burton, who a decade later would perform Camelot in front of John F. Kennedy and his wife, Jacqueline. Eventually, Burton learned that Churchill, the writer-statesman, knew several Shakespeare productions by heart. At intermissions, Burton spotted Churchill's empty seat. Winston was right there, and thought he'd left for the night. Backstage, however, the Prime Minister was waiting in his dressing room. The actor hoped Churchill might praise his performance, but instead the latter had been motivated by nature's demands. My Lord Hamlet, may I use your lavatory? The Nobel winner beseeched, and without any shilly-shally, he did. So, when we talk about these two families, I don't know if you remember in high school, sometimes we get that blue essay book, and you had to fill it out, and they say compare and contrast. Well, in a way, this was an exercise in compare and contrast. And it was very much motivated by my son Taylor and I went to dinner with Steven Schlesinger. We were on a panel together about JFK a few years ago, and Taylor happened to be free. He was with us. But Arthur Schlesinger asked Stephen's father, who was the Kennedy historian, the well-known historian, he once asked, and I asked it more than once, as a matter of fact, he said, why is it that Joe Kennedy, who was such a diplomatic failure, such a failure as a politician, was able to achieve greatness with his sons, how his sons were able to achieve greatness, and yet two genuinely great men, Winston Churchill and FDR, their sons had difficulties and there were somewhat, shall we say, disappointments. And that is something that this book attempts to try to deal with. That's one of the questions that I try to deal with here when we talk about fathers and sons, about the burdens of legacy, about fame, about money, and how these things happen. My book begins in 1930, and at that point, Winston is in his 50s. He's in what he would later describe, it was later described by others, as his wilderness years, in which he was out of power. He genuinely thought that his best days were over, that he certainly, his dream of someday becoming prime minister would not happen. JFK, at this point, 1930, 31, 32, he's about 15 years of age. He's a very sickly boy, a boy who is more sick than we would ever learn, even when he was president, suffering from Addison's disease and was in and out of a number of different hospital beds. And so these two, Winston and JFK, we begin our story at their low points, quite arguably. The flip side, the fathers and sons, you have Randolph, who at that stage looks like he's going to be the prime minister. He looks like a Leonardo DiCaprio type. You know, he's a terrific orator. His father watches him and he's astounded because Winston has to spend all night reading his speeches to Brendan Bracken but he's got to have them just right. And whereas Randolph is just a natural, he's great. And particularly as the two families get to know one another, it's clear that Randolph is a much bigger star, if you will, and has a seemingly a greater, a brighter future than any of the Kennedy sons. And of course, as I mentioned, Joe is a multimillionaire at that point. He himself is still thinking that after FDR runs for only two, because after all, presidents only serve two terms, that he would have a shot maybe in 1940 at becoming a president. But of course, his political career explodes because of his appeasement during World War II, his isolationism, his feeling that Britain is doomed to be beaten by Hitler and that we would be fools in the United States to get involved in that war. The story of how Winston and JFK overcome adversity is a big part of the dynamic of this book. It's something that I hope people can walk away and learn something and apply to their own lives. It's also a world, although it's a world run by great men and their sons, what I'd like to think is that this book also introduces us to a number of women in their lives who were not these casual affairs but rather people, women of great substance, of great intelligence, at times arguably smarter than the men that they were involved with. Certainly Rose dealing with an adulterous husband, but how she winds up living for what she called the family enterprise and how she helped shape that family. One of the most fascinating characters, I think, is Pamela Churchill, who Bill Clinton later appoints as the ambassador to France. But she was the first wife of Randolph Churchill, and she's a key figure in the whole telling of that time period leading up to World War II. The idea that Randolph felt that he had been, in his words, cuckolded by Pamela because of her affair with Averell Harriman, who ironically was the man that the president sent over to replace Joe Kennedy. You know, it's been such a disaster that he sent somebody over that he trusts and he knew, and it wound up that Harriman, our former governor of New York, had an affair with Pamela during the war, and Randolph is out in the North Africa. He's with the commandos. He's trying to show that he will be a man of war, that he will show that he's a great man through the theater of war. And everybody in London seems to know about his wife's affair, except poor Randolph. And that's a story that continues throughout his whole life. And of course, no story about the Kennedys would be complete without Jackie Kennedy. And I was really amazed how much she was a fan of Winston Churchill. There's a tale earlier on, way before she meets Jack Kennedy, where she's in college and she goes on a European tour and she actually shakes Winston's hand, not once, but then gets back on the line again and shakes his hand a second time. She became very good friends with Randolph Churchill. And I think her insights about Randolph are among the most sensitive in my book. And of course, the interchange between these two families that occurs in 1958 is something that I think most people don't understand, that the Churchills were friendly with Aristotle Onassis, and Winston would go on these long cruises. There was one cruise in 1958 in which Jack Kennedy was in the Mediterranean on vacation with Jackie, and it's arranged that Jack will meet Winston Churchill, and Jackie meets Aristotle Onassis for the first time, her future husband. So, all these different coincidences and these remarkable interconnections are throughout this book, and there's so many of them. When I talk about the mutual friends, of course, the Roosevelts have to be mentioned first, because Roosevelt, FDR, he appoints Joe to become our ambassador in London. Joe is the head fundraiser in 1932 for FDR. He's the one who convinces, for instance, William Randolph Hearst to get the California delegation Franklin the nomination on, I believe it's the fourth ballot at the 32 convention. These things are largely lost to history. But when you put when you put it from the connection of these two families and you realize all of the different connections that they had with mutual friends, of course, FDR, his friendship with Winston throughout the war is has been written about quite a bit. And FDR defined, if you will, in a sense, both Joe Kennedy and to some degree, certainly Winston. And together, FDR and Winston, they embody the special relationship between the United States and Britain. Another mutual friend is Bernard Baruch. And without going into great detail, because I do in the book, but it was in looking up, knowing that Winston was friends, his best friend in America was Bernard Baruch, lived at the Waldorf Astoria. But when I put in the words Bernard Baruch into the computerized Churchill archives over in England, and I'm sitting there in London, Long Island, excuse me, as I'm typing in Bernard Baruch, up comes some stocks that Winston Churchill owned, including Brooklyn Manhattan Transit, which was a company that Joe Kennedy controlled with Bernard Baruch. Lo and behold, another company, National Distillers, is a company that Joe is the franchise. He's the New England franchise representative for National Distillers. And so in 1933, October of 33, there's a visit in which it's nearing Prohibition, just like Boardwalk Empire, in which Joe is looking to capitalize. It's going to be the end of Prohibition, that liquor is going to be a very substantial business, and he wants to be first online. And indeed, he was first online. What he does is he gets in a boat with Jimmy Roosevelt, who is Franklin Roosevelt's oldest son, and they go over, and they essentially, Joe gets the British liquor contracts. Jimmy winds up getting the insurance contracts back and forth of the shipments of liquor from Great Britain to the United States. And Winston, as it turns out, who had lost money in the 1929 crash and worried about he was broke, that he might have to shutter Chartwell or at least parts of it, he obtains a large amount of stock in two American companies, these two American companies that are tied to Joe. Now, what do we make of that? Well, I urge you to read the book and you tell me what you make of it. I would think that perhaps, you know, binder's fees or gratuity, or I certainly wouldn't necessarily use the phrase bribe, but it's something that is, it's an interesting exchange that goes on, that suddenly Winston has got this stock when he's broke. And that's, has never been said before. And I wouldn't come to any legal or anything, any type of conclusion there. What I would say, though, is that deal kind of illustrates so many of the interconnections between Baruch, the great friend of Winston, and obviously Joe Kennedy, that had never been said before. And it really underlines how much they were not only friendly acquaintances, but they were also engaged in various different businesses and such. Well, they had some of the same business associates and such. Now, why has that never been said before, as I mentioned at the outset here? Well, I think part of it is that certainly Winston didn't want to be advertising the fact after World War II that he was friendly with Joe Kennedy. That was a horrendous thing. You know, most people hated Joe Kennedy over in Britain. And Joe Kennedy was determined to write his own memoir. In fact, up at the JFK Library, there's a long, almost completely done memoir that was never published by Joe, and in which he tries to set the record straight, and his time in London. And clearly, Jack Kennedy prevailed on his father and said, "Dad, forget about it." And they actually wound up giving money back to the ghostwriter that prepared the memoir. So Joe's memoir was never published. Winston, of course, said, "I will write my own history." And he took all of his papers, and we have these wonderful books that he wrote about World War II, and that later these papers were used by Randolph Churchill to write his father's biography, along with, obviously, Martin Gilbert, who carries through when Randolph dies. So what is new and important in this book, besides some of the things I hopefully have impressed you with already? One is certainly the role of independent-minded women in their lives. I was really determined that that would be a big part of this storytelling, not only with people like Kay Halley, who was a woman who was would be Randolph's fiance at one point. Winston has to come over here to the United States and kind of put the kibosh on that marriage. But Kay Halley is also becomes an intimate of Joe Kennedy's, but also becomes a longtime family friend. So she's in the beginning of the book in 1930s, but later in 1960, it's Kay Halley who convinces Jack, then the president, in 1963, in the Rose Garden, to award U.S. honorary citizenship to Winston Churchill. And Winston, by that point, is too old to attend. So it's Randolph, and perhaps his finest moment, who stands up there for his father and accepts the honorary citizenship. It's all part of the interconnections between these two families. Without going on and on here, there's a lot of other stories in the book that I hope you get a chance to enjoy, having to do with spying, the role of the Vatican, and as a hubbub of spies leading up to World War II, and how Joe taps into that, the case of Tyler Kent, and how Winston was involved from a distance, kind of overseeing this spy case of Tyler Kent, a man who's basically making copies of the secret correspondence between FDR and Churchill leading to World War II, and he's making copies of it, and they're in the hands of the Nazis. And this is Joe's employee. And it was a case that haunted the Kennedys in ways that I found amazing, even to 1961, when Bobby Kennedy becomes the Attorney General and he meets with J. Edgar Hoover for the first time. One of the first things he asked for is the Tyler Kent spy case. Why is he asking that? And you can see in the book how it haunted the Kennedys for years. There's aspects of, if you will, the hyphenated aspects of both these families. Winston's mother was born in Brooklyn, and grandfather, Jerome, right? Barry, we have Jerome Avenue up by the Fordham campus, yay, in the Bronx, and that is named for one of Churchill's descendants. So this idea that he was both half American and as well as obviously totally, wholeheartedly devoted to Britain and the British Empire and all everything that made it great is a big part of the constitution of Winston. And of course, the Kennedys, what got me involved in this story is I wrote a book about 10 years ago about the Kennedys and about how their Irish Catholic immigrant background informed their personal and public lives. So in many ways, they were hyphenated as well. They had their feet in two different camps. Jack ran in 1960. The number one issue was his Catholicism. And so this idea of being both insiders and outsiders, having a foot in two different camps, applied in a sense to both families. And I found that endlessly important. And I also think, particularly in the case of JFK, who I've barely spoken about tonight, you know, I think historically it's really important to recognize that Jack Kennedy was the first president from a minority background. That was a big part of his story in 1960. But I think it's very important for people like myself, biographers and historians, not to try to do a Freudian analysis on presidents the way in which poor Richard Nixon has been psychoanalyzed to death in numerous books. I think I would suggest that presidential character is more influenced by culture. And you can document things in their letters about religion, about the sense of ethnicity, the sense of social strata and where they are. And that's a big part of who and what people are, particularly if you come from a minority background. So I think that's a big part of it. And I also think this book speaks to how Winston and Jack Kennedy influenced our world today. I would be very curious to see how both Churchill and Kennedy would be dealing with the Middle East, with Syria. I think one of the subtle things I'd like to hope that you pick up in reading my book is that Winston quite successfully offloads or bequeaths, if you will, the British Empire to the United States. In a sense, a lot of the imperial obligations, responsibilities have been assumed by the United States. And I think that's part of the history as well here. In concluding, basically what I wanted to do with this book is I was very pleased that the review so far, I've used one particular word, sprawling. And, well, it certainly says that you'll get your money's worth if you buy the book. But it also, it is what I wanted to do. I wanted to write a family saga, almost like you would try to write a great American novel. You know, unfortunately, novelists these days are very insular, very relatively small subjects. But this was a book filled with war, spying. It's got great adventures in it. It's got intrigue, betrayal. It's got family loyalties, great, the greatest of ambitions. It's asked, what does it mean to be great? And that's what is really the themes that's throughout this book. Finally, there's peace between these two families. It comes in the early 1960s, and it comes in a number of different poignant moments, I would suggest. One particular is Joe Kennedy in a second floor window watching as his son, JFK, in 1963, Joe's crippled, can't speak, he's in a wheelchair, he's looking out a window, and he's watching his son, Jack, give U.S. honorary citizenship, never given before, to Winston Churchill, the man who arguably was his great nemesis on the issue of the war and had had so many difficulties with. You just have to wonder, what was he actually thinking? What was going through his head at that moment? After the assassination, Randolph, in friendship, he gives a complete, this is a few years after the assassination, he gives to Jackie Kennedy, in friendship, a complete copy of Winston's books so that her son, John F. Kennedy Jr., would be able to read it one day. And I'd like to end with just the end of my book that describes that scene. It says, quote, Winston Churchill and Randolph outlived Jack, but maybe Randolph will be the one to draw John Jr. to the books that shaped John's father, Jacqueline Kennedy, would later write. This legacy between fathers and sons, mothers and daughters, the eternal questions about families and fate, and our lasting impressions of greatness were all part of the shared experience between the Churchills and the Kennedys. This gift of books from the son of Winston to the son of Jack Kennedy, was only one more example in this saga, a small but meaningful gesture between them. Little was known publicly about their private exchanges because those involved wanted it kept that way, as if only they could understand one another, lifelong participants born in the political arena with all the blood, brains, and passion that drives family dynasties from one generation to the next. Thank you so much for being here, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
His senior thesis, his first book on why England slept.
Exactly.
What effect did that have on his father?
Well, it's interesting because when he shows the draft to both his father and his older brother, they realize in a very muted way that Jack kind of agrees with Churchill about defenses and that that the United States should be more mindful about building up its defenses. And later on in 1960, when Jack Kennedy runs for president, he mentions Churchill a number of times on the stump, but he particularly talks about the experience of Stanley Baldwin and the what Churchill would call the locust years, those years when we were asleep at the wheel, in which, you know, people who had been traumatized by World War I didn't want to get involved in any war in Britain, and led, of course, to the vacuum that Hitler so notoriously filled. So it had a much more subtle but very substantive impact on Jack Kennedy. And Jack Kennedy became of age. In fact, part of this book is an attempt, in the way that I tried to explain the Irish Catholic immigrant background of the Kennedys and how that influenced Kennedy's personal, private. The years in London, almost like nature versus nurture, the experiences nurtured Jack Kennedy, and a lot of his sense of British traditions were informed there. And Winston was the epitome in his eyes for that. Yes, sir.
Yes, lovely talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm just curious, outside of Joseph Kennedy's appointment to the Court of St. James, what was the seminal point of their meeting, of their getting together or having a relationship? What was the meeting?
Well, you know, as I mentioned, there was some of the business contacts with people like Baruch. There was another character who I think has never been written before like this, a fellow named Lord Beaverbrook, who was kind of like like the Rupert Murdoch of our times. He was a press baron, and he was one of Winston's best friends, arguably his best friend. But Joe had done business with Lord Beaverbrook in the early 30s, actually in the 20s, about selling some of the movies in Hollywood that he was involved with, selling them overseas. So he knew Beaverbrook. So there was a lot of different connections, social, business. And when the Kennedys come over to London, it's really fascinating to watch that. It's in my book, obviously, but there's even, excuse me, there's some video that's on YouTube that you can watch. When the Kennedys come over, you know, Joe Kennedy knew how to put on a show. He was a Hollywood producer. So they always had great camera people. It's great moments there. And they loved the Kennedys, the Brits. They loved the Kennedys. When he first arrives in 38, there's a lot of coverage about that. One of the people that writes quite a bit about them is Randolph Churchill, who's writing a column for Lord Beaverbrook in his newspaper. So there was a lot of connections between them during that time period. I hope. Yes, sir.
You made me start thinking about some of the personal differences between JFK and Churchill in terms of personality. And this is one of the first times I did it, and just in my mind, I found it quite starting, striking how different they were on a personal level. Can you comment on that?
Well, to me, their similarities, frankly, are what appealed to me and I thought was most striking, because I think JFK really identified with Churchill. I mentioned a woman named Kay Halley. There's a scene early in my book where she goes to the hospital with Joe Kennedy in Boston, and young Jack is in the hospital bed, and what does he have there? He's reading Winston Churchill's World Crisis book. So it was one of those things that I think there's more similarities between them. To answer your question, where they divert, they were diverse. Well, certainly, I think probably the first thing would be as husbands. Winston's parents had a rather randy background, and kind of, if not randy, certainly something that as a young man he was very hurt by. And I think he was very devoted to his wife, Clementine. And obviously, Jack had a very different view about marriage. So I think that would be probably, on the personal level, their biggest differences. Politically, it's interesting to see about JFK, because he's very much a cold warrior when he runs in 1960. After the Cuban Missile Crisis, it raises the whole question about what would Kennedy have done, not only with the Soviets, but with Vietnam? And I think in the way that Winston was a proponent of empire, of the British Empire, certainly, I think late in his life, late in his presidency, Kennedy had second thoughts about that. And there's a lot of what ifs about Vietnam that, frankly, we'll just never know. Yes, sir.
Thanks again for your time. You just mentioned Mrs. Churchill, and you know, you were talking earlier about the role of women in each of the great men's life. But I didn't think I heard you speak anything about Mrs. Churchill and her role in stabilizing, you know,
yes, you're absolutely right. There's only a certain amount of time that I have, and you should, by all means, read the book. But in a nutshell, Winston's wife, Clementine, was a great rock for him. She was the one who would tell Winston if he was up here, "Well, it was a good speech that you gave, but next time, bear in mind that one thing that you said there." And she was able to give him that dose of candor that he valued. And even with somebody like Lord Beaverbrook, there's letters, there's a warning that she says about Beaverbrook, and is he really your friend? So she was totally devoted to Winston. In the context of that family itself, of the children, one has to, as a historian, as a biographer, take everything with a grain of salt. But, I think generally speaking, the Churchill marriage was, in a way, kind of like Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan. They were completely devoted to one another. And sometimes the children seem to be almost afterthoughts. There are marriages. There's a lot of marriages that are like that. And I'm not trying to, cast aspersions necessarily on that. That's just the way it was. They both Clementine, and Winston had come from families themselves where it was very uncertain about their backgrounds and their parents' families were very unstable in a sense. And they were determined to be there for one another, to always to be completely devoted to one another. And Winston always was. Great.
Thank you again.
Barry, thank you so much for having
a wonderful talk.
I really appreciate it.
I think logistically, for those of you who'd like to get a book and get it signed, you should just come right up here. The books are here. We'll have Tom sit here. And we are also going to serve a little progeny champagne because what would a Churchill event be without a progeny?
Wow.
So thank you again.
First class all the way.
And let's bring it
only the best. A Chartwell, as Winston would say, right?
Yeah. I really appreciate it.
I'm going to get to pull the mic out of the way. So if you don't mind sitting for a few minutes.
No, not at all.